could tell a story. If my life would sing a song. If I have a testimony. If I have anything at all. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. His faithful hand has held me all this way. And when I'm old and gray, and all my days are numbered on the earth, let it be known in you alone my joy was found. My children tell their children. Let this be their memory. That all my treasure was in heaven.
Good morning.
And you were everything.
It's good to see you made it here today because, as always, we've gathered here in the name of Jesus Christ. Glory be to God. He's alive. He lives. It's Saturday morning. Beautiful morning. It's a little bit chilly. We had some rain last night, which is a good sign because where there's rain, there is no snow. Winter has come to an end. But so you wake up this morning, nice, fresh, clean smell. Smells good, feels good. It's a little chilly. I'm sick of the cold, ready for summer and the warmth summer brings. But nevertheless, it's a beautiful morning. And I'm glad you've joined us here today. There will be no service, official service, tomorrow, Sunday morning, because I'm the only one here. It's my son's birthday, and happy birthday to my son. And so everybody's kind of out of town this weekend. I don't have my sound guy, my music man, and nobody's going to be here. Nobody's here but me. So no official services this Sunday or tomorrow. But I did think, you know, hey, why not sit back and let's read the Bible. This week I've been working out in the yard, so didn't do a whole lot of the Bible study stuff, you know. But that being said, there's plenty of information out there. Not just from me, but from all different sources. And the number one best source for the gathering of your knowledge should be you reading the Bible. You reading the Word of God for what it is for yourself, you know. And I've had this conversation with people throughout the years, you know. You cannot influence another person, really, unless they desire to seek it, unless they're already seeking it out. You must first seek out the kingdom of heaven in order to reap the rewards that are spoken of in the Bible. You must seek God out. And even if you've grown up in a church setting as children, it's going to have no effect on you. It's going to have no impact in your life unless you seek it out for yourself. You desire to know it for yourself. You seek the face of the Lord for yourself. You must do that. And great way to start or to begin is to find out who God is there inside of the Word of God, which we believe this is the Word of God, and it's useful for training men and people in righteousness. It's useful for finding out the definition of what is holiness. You know, your clothing doesn't make you holy. The way you dress, there's so many misinformation about head coverings that people can't even connect with God or with the body of believers because they're so wrapped up in clothing and in an appearance. You know, I seen one of the most horrific, most disgusting things I've ever seen in my life, and you know, this could only happen in a foreign country outside of the United States, I believe, you know, and if it happens here, you know, and we do nothing, what does that say to us, about us? You know, it's always been known, it's throughout all the Bible, throughout all world history, that the world will never be taken over by evil. Evil will never stand, it will never have a place of absolute authority. That the only thing that even allows evil to exist is good people who are not willing to do anything about the evil they see. You know, and I saw this person who has been deemed as being a holy person, and they call themselves the Dalai Lama, which is the incarnation of Buddha, which to me is a religion of demonic behavior. There's no God in it. Sure, you can say, I found the way of enlightenment, the way of having peace, and yet in their way of light enlightenment, you know, it's all follow the Ten Commandments, or the Nine Commandments, because they don't believe in God. They only believe in reincarnation and constantly being reborn into a world of suffering. Of suffering, even forcing themselves into a place of suffering, claiming that the suffering that they inflict themselves with is what makes them holy, and yet I don't believe in any of that. And I have completely been convinced that the Dalai Lama is filled with the satanic spirit when he says to a little boy, a little child, come and suck on my tongue. And you're lucky you're not in America. I think good Americans would rise up and kill that man. And I'm not condoning violence of any kind or of any sort, but if good men, if good people don't do anything, they allow evil to exist, and that's what gives evil power and authority. And as Jesus says, you know, you violate the children of God, it'd be better for you to just kill yourself put a millstone around your neck and throw yourself into the sea, drown yourself, than it would ever be to hurt the child. And I don't know. We as human beings, made in the image of God, how much longer are we going to stand back and allow these demonic people, people filled with demons, devils, mock us and mock God and mock our faith, our religion, when Christianity, all of Christianity is wrapped around doing good, doing righteous things. And again, I don't condone violence in any way, but what makes us righteous? Any more righteous than any other group of people as a believer? But what makes you holy? What separates you from the rest of anything else out here in God's creation? And I would hope it's all defined by your willingness to stand up for what you believe in. And then you believing in righteousness. You being willing to take that stand to defend the defenseless. That's all of what the Bible stands for. It's what it all stands for. Even Abraham rose up, made for himself a little army of his gathering or his followers, and went and rescued Lot from the hands of those who were in Gomorrah. You know, there's so many times in the Bible where it defines the Israelite people because of their willingness to stand up for what they believed in, and what they believed in was righteousness. They brought righteousness into the world, and I think without the teachings and instructions of God, without the Israelite people taking a stand for what they believed in, we would have never come to have known righteousness. The things that are right and, you know, God comes into a place where there's chaos, disorder. And he transforms that chaos into order. And that order comes through laws. And the law is an agreement about, from all people, that this is good because it protects the most vulnerable. It protects the least. It protects the individual. It protects you and it protects me. It protects my wife if we have one. It protects our husband if we have one. It protects our children. It protects our family. It protects our communities and our nation. And it's for that reason God put in to this world a system of laws. It's for our protection. Which, I don't know. I've had on my mind the Tower of Babel. Genesis chapter 11. And God, right, is not the author of confusion, but he is the author of our faith. He is the author of righteousness. He is the author of hope. He is the author of joy, of life, the author of holiness. And see that, you know, in this Tower of Babel, it's very short. And there's a few things that in there that it seems like it is always fighting against God. And has been. That this creation of this here society. And it reads like this. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone and bitumen, which is tar or asphalt, for mortar. And they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens. And let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. And the Lord said, behold, they are one people, and they have all one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. Nothing that they purpose to do will now be impossible for them. So come, let us go down there and confuse their language so that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off the building the city. Therefore its name was called Babel or Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth. So one, I see communism. And again, this are the children of man, not the children of God so much. It doesn't say the sons of God decided to do this, but the children of man was going to do this. The sons of man, mankind, came up with the idea to create city, which is community. Everybody working for a common goal. And everybody working for the city, the rulers of the city. For those who came up with the idea, they're gonna present their bricks burnt in fire, tried in fire, right? And the burnt bricks or the fire, the bricks that were made from fire were much harder than those made from the sun. And they didn't want to use stone. Instead, they wanted to use something made by the power of their own hands, the power of their own might, through the the power of their own ideology, minds. They wanted to create, and they wanted to create a common goal for all people, in that they we see maybe pride, that these people were motivated by pride. We want to make for ourselves a name. And I could see a lot of people as here in today, same thing is going on. It's inside of this artificial intelligence or AI. And now all of a sudden there's groups of people who are trying to convince the world, convince individual countries, individual people that we all must work together for a one world government, a one world system of rules and laws, and we're going to put an end to borders throughout all nations, and that trying to get the people to willingly accept this new one world communism. But people are never willing to be a part of communism. Communism must be enforced upon the people. Nowhere in world history did anybody accept communism. No, millions upon millions, hundreds of millions of people were murdered and raped and pillaged in order for communism to be forced upon the masses. And it was forced upon those who were most vulnerable. That once all the husbands and the protectors and the defenders were destroyed, all that was left was children and women and the most vulnerable. And there they then enforced their will upon another person's will, and saying, hey, let us all work together for the city, for the government. Let us all work together for the creation of this tower. And I see the tower today, the idol. See their very work and the worship of their work, the idol, and they were working for the idol, and the idol was the city. The idol was the brick that held their name, that gave them purpose. We see it today in AI, in the tower. Everybody contributing their post and their memes and all their stuff. And that's our brick. Even there in the Facebook. Here, let me provide for you my face, my brick, my existence, my part in the puzzle, you know, and that's the thing with AI. It's outside of the intelligence human put into it. Humanity has instilled into it. It has no intelligence. All it does is process and organize the data that's entered into it. But it isn't a thinking machine, and it has no spirit. Absent in the spirit of man that fills it. You know, if AI was absolutely so intelligent, more intelligent than the man who created it, why then can it not only create itself? Why can't it create one of us, a human being? Has not the intelligence to do neither. But we have the ability to do both. And that's the intelligence of mankind. This comes through the intelligence of God. I thought they could create a system better than the system that God had created. You know? And it's like that. You go to the city, it's very community-oriented. No matter what city we go to, very community-oriented. The people of the city are dependent upon the members of its community. You go out into farmland and country life, and it's the opposite. They don't... Community means nothing to them. Because they do everything as individuals. Individual farming and taking care of themselves, being self-sustained, these homesteaders. And in their homesteading stuff, I sometimes wonder if it's an act of selfishness. Some of the most selfish people I've ever met in my life live in the country. They all had a common language, one language. It's kind of like today. Everybody has a common language, one language, no matter where you go on earth, except for Mexico. People speak English. In every country, they teach English so that the whole world can communicate with one another. Except for Mexico, they're Spanish only, incapable of teaching their community English. Maybe it's good, maybe it's bad. God decides to confuse their language. It's kind of like God saying, I don't accept this thing, you know, this way of life. One thing all communist governments have taken upon themselves is the destruction of the Bible, the destruction of faith in the Bible, the destruction Christianity, the church, the gathering of believers. Very common in all forms of communist governments. In order for a communist government to come to power, it comes to power through deceptive practices, that of propaganda. We create a lie and then we beat you down into believing that lie because that is the devil, the author of lies. When the devil's lips move, lies spew out. It is an attack against God and the truth. And we're engaged in all these lies and deception and the works of propaganda. And people will do anything for money. They'll do anything for money. They'll do anything to gain some sort of fame. Recognition. Validation. And those who are workers of lies and deception, propaganda, they will find you. If you're willing to do anything for money, they welcome you. They'll welcome you. And all this, you know, I think leads us back to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And I get it. There's so many people out there who want to make the claim that speaking in some sort of an unknown language, showing signs and wonders, and wanting everyone to believe in some sort of this miracles, and I do believe God does miracles, but I think more importantly, the greatest miracle of all is gathering together a group of people who stand for what they believe, and the things that they stand for are the acts of righteousness and good. They protect and take care of the most vulnerable, which is not, it's not in the nature of man to do that. Man or beast, creepy crawly, or fishes of the sea. The strongest must survive. The strongest always prevail. The strongest beat down and take advantage of the weak and vulnerable. That's nature. It's normal. But the miracle of God is bringing order to a place where there is no order. Chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians says it like this. Pursue love and earnestly desire the spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy. And to prophesy isn't to tell the future. So many people think that a prophet speaks of events or things that are to come, but absolutely not. Not a fortune teller, not a witch, not a tarot card reader. Nothing to do with the future. It has everything to do with speaking the word of God. That's what a prophet does. He speaks the word of God. Because it's in hearing the word of God, people are saved, people are transformed. So many people say, I'm a prophet of God, and let me show you the presence of God. Let me show you the presence of the Holy Spirit, and then separate themselves from the Holy Spirit by saying, hey, right here, right here, right here, right here is the Holy Spirit. It's right here. And yeah, you can't see it, you don't know about it, but here, come up here onto my stage, into my area, and when you walk right here through this, when you come in and you walk here, you'll feel and be overcome by the Holy Spirit, and people come up and they walk and pass out, whatever. And I think it's all a joke. It's all how when Jesus says, beware of those, they'll come and they'll preach to you signs and wonders. And they're going to say, look, over there is the Holy Spirit. Over there, Jesus can be found. Out there. And it's, but never can they confess that the Holy Spirit is within the heart of man. The Holy Spirit is within the heart of you. Because they're separating you from God. These same groups of people are always speaking in unknown languages. In a language known as Babel. Babbling. The whole word Babel is a Hebrew word, babbling. It's a word of a speech of utter confusion. And what is the confusion comes from what? Separation from them and God. Nowhere in the Bible is there ever people spoke in unknown languages. And there is mention that God, people would come and hear from a people of a language they didn't know, but that's the thing that separating Gentiles from the Israelites and saying it's from the Gentiles, the Israelites, we're going to come to know God. For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God, for no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the spirit. On the other hand, the one who prophesies speaks to the people for their upbuilding and encouragement and consolation. The one who speaks in a tongue builds up himself, but the one who prophesies builds up the church. Now, I want you all to speak in tongues, but even more to prophesy. And in speaking in tongues, you know, why it's in languages. All language is spoken for the purpose of communication and communicating with other people. As I am communicating with you in a language we can understand, and there's many languages throughout all the world, and as Paul saying, I speak of many tongues, right? And he spoke Greek, he spoke Hebrew, Aramaic, he spoke probably Latin, many different languages. You speak in a language nobody can understand, it benefits nobody. It's just a mystery. And is God a mystery? Does God want to be known as a mystery? Is inside the mystery chaos, confusion? Is it all about the individual? And I think it is all about the individual, and they use this confusion, this mystery, as a form of manipulation. Same way a communist government manipulates its people through the acts of propaganda and the spreading of false news or information, trying to get people to believe in a lie over that of the truth. The author of deception is Satan. Doesn't matter what group we're in. It's, you know, does our discernment come from? Where does our discernment come from? Now I want you to speak in tongues, but even more to prophesy. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless someone interprets so that the church may be built up. If there is no interpreter, if the language can't be interpreted, it is absolutely void of God, I believe. And I believe Paul is saying the same thing. It's not like this was something new. This was something going on. Remember, he's talking to Corinthians, people who worshiped demons and devils and idols. And now we're coming to know the true God. And maybe they're trying to bring with them these foreign practices, these things that they were engaged in prior to coming to know the Lord. And now Paul is saying, hey, wait a minute, let's talk about this. Let's discuss this. Now, brothers, if I come to you speaking in tongues, how will I benefit you unless I bring you some revelation or knowledge or prophecy or teaching? If even lifeless instruments, such as a flute or a harp, do not give distinct notes, how will anyone know what is played? And if a bugle gives an indistinct sound, who will get ready for battle? So with yourselves, if with your tongue you utter speech that is not intelligible, how will anyone know what is said? For you will be speaking into the air. There are doubtless many different languages in the world, and none is without meaning. But if I do not know the meaning of the language, I will be a foreigner to the speaker, and the speaker a foreigner to me. So are we foreigners to God? Are we strangers to God? And if we're speaking in some language, acting as if we're speaking to God, but I have no idea what it is I am saying, and I have no idea what God is saying. And as people claim that they are speaking by the Spirit, through the Spirit, about spiritual things, and it's all being used as a form of manipulation, trying to manipulate people while bolstering themselves into being something greater than you yourself. Bigger than you, more knowledgeable than you, separating myself from you, and in it, making yourselves strangers to God, a foreigner to God, a foreigner to those who are listening, strangers. We see that in the story of the Tower of Babel, God confused their language because what they were doing was absolute nonsense. It made no sense. It was all for the building up of a false temple, the Tower was the representation of a temple. God clearly showing I'm not in that temple. I'm separated from that temple. We came down to see what they were doing, and God said they ain't doing any good. No good will come from this. All language has meaning. And so many people, the people who have come accustomed to believing that this form of manipulation is the presence of the Holy Spirit speaking through them in some language they have no idea is, they refuse to admit it's wrong, it's bad, it's not of God. Because it makes them insignificant. At least that's what they feel. So with yourselves, since you're eager for manifestation of the Spirit, strive to excel in building up the church. If you're eager to have the manifestation of the Holy Spirit seen in presence, then strive to excel in the building up of the church. Therefore, one who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may be interpreted. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. What am I to do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will pray with my mind also. I will sing praise with my spirit, but I will sing with my mind also. Otherwise, if you give thanks with your spirit, how can anyone in the position of an outsider say amen to your thanksgiving when he does not know what you are saying? For you may be giving thanks well enough, but the other person is not being built up. I thank God that I speak in tongues. And he says tongues, not is I speak in many languages, more than all of you. Nevertheless, in church, I would rather speak 5 words with my mind in order to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue no one can understand. So, you know, it's interesting how so many people throughout, I don't know, the world, refuse to recognize that. If we're going to speak in church, if we're going to speak in public, if we're going to speak in a language that is good and useful for the building up of the church, and therefore it must be understood, I wouldn't speak a single word if no one could understand it, let alone thousands of words that no one could understand. I'd rather speak 5 words that had value and meaning. And people, how can you not understand what that says? That just seems like such plain language. Brothers, do not be children in your thinking. Be infants in evil, but in your thinking be mature. In the law it is written by people of strange tongues and by the lips of foreigners, I will speak to this people. And even when they do not listen to me, says the Lord, thus tongues are a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers who Thus tongues are a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers. While prophesying is a sign not for unbelievers, but for believers. And I the sign somebody is an unbeliever to me, this is what I read it as, the sign someone is an unbeliever is when they're speaking in these unknown languages, that's the sign of an unbeliever. Not of believers. Believers prophesy. Believers speak the word of God. Because the word of God is near to you. The word of God is within you. And the word of God is understandable. It is not a mystery. It is not chaos. It is not coming from Babel. Even when the Lord spoke there in the book of Genesis, let us go down and see what's going on. You could understand every word the Lord was saying. It was the people who didn't know the Lord who spoke in languages that could not be understood. When you speak about it, it's almost as though I'm was speaking in a clear language. Paul is clearly speaking in an understandable language, and I can't understand it. I can't receive it. I refuse to believe in it. I'm going to continue doing the things that I feel comfortable with, because in doing that, I'm able to manipulate weak-minded people. And that's what they seek to do, is manipulate folks, bolstering themselves and into places of divinity, divination. If therefore the whole church comes together and all speak in tongues, and outsiders or unbelievers enter, will they not say, you are out of your minds? You guys are out of your minds. And these are logical thinking people. They'll come, they'll see it, and you guys are out of your minds. You are... make no sense. You're fools. But if all prophesy and an unbeliever or an outside enters, he is convicted by all. He is called to account by all. The secrets of his heart are disclosed. And so, falling on his face, he will worship God and declare that God is really among you. That is the most clearest statement you can read it in the Bible. That if you speak the word of God and you speak with intelligence, people will say God is really among you. Especially strangers, the people God is calling to himself. They'll say there is order here. There's structure here. Surely God can be known. That they're convicted by all. They fall on their face and they confess God is here. That's good. And that's the sign of believers. Believers want to make God known. They want you to know God. And they want you to have faith in God, and faith comes by hearing the word of God, not hearing the words of Babel. Faith does not come by witnessing miracles. Faith comes by hearing the word of God, and the word of God has the power to transform people into being upstanding, righteous citizens who are willing to take a stand for something they believe in. But how can I take a stand in something I believe in when I don't even know what it is I'm listening to? Yeah, I'm speaking against those who speak in tongues. Especially tongues that can never be interpreted. Even Paul says when we pray, I'm going to pray with my mind. I'm going to pray with wisdom and knowledge. I'm not going to pray in some form of babel or confusion. God is not the author of confusion. What then, brothers? When you come together, each one has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. Let all things be done for building up. If any speaks in a tongue or in a language, let there be only two or at most three, and each in turn, and let someone interpret. But if there's no one to interpret, let each of them keep silent in the church and speak to himself and to God. But if you think you really have some sort of connection with God through this unknown language, that language that cannot be interpreted, then absolutely stay silent. Keep silent. And there are people who cannot understand this language. Even if it's spoken to them in a language they can understand, they refuse to receive it. They refuse to understand it because ultimately they're unwilling to surrender to God. Surrender to the order of God. God is order. They're unwilling to surrender to the Spirit of God, the instruction of God, the law and rule of God. It's all about them. It's all about themselves. Let two or three prophets speak, and let the others weigh what is said. If a revelation is made to another sitting there, let the first be silent. For you can all prophesy one by one, so that all may learn and be encouraged. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets, for God is not the God of confusion, but of peace. As in all the churches of the saints. The women should keep silent in the churches, for they are not permitted to speak, but should be submissive, as the law also says. If there is anything they desire to learn, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is shameful for a woman to speak in church. Or was it from you that the word of God came? Or are you the only ones it has reached? If anyone thinks he is a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that the things that I am writing to you are a command of the Lord. If anyone does not recognize this, he is not recognized. So my brothers earnestly desire to prophesy and do not forbid the speaking in tongues, but all things should be done decently and in order. again, and in order, and everybody being submissive to the law and the rule of God, because it is the law and the rule of God that brings order and peace. We're not a people of chaos. We're not a people who seek to manipulate others for the personal gain of ourselves or our own fame. But we're here to build up the church by bringing order to the church that comes through our willingness to submit to the Word of God, to the law of God, to the teachings and instructions of God. And how will you ever come to know the teachings and instructions of God? You don't need to be submitting yourself to man or the teachings of man, but submit yourself to the Word of God. And maybe that means reading the Word of God on your own, by yourself, absent of an interpreter, praying and asking God to reveal His wisdom to you. Every word in here can be understood, and that's the Word of God. Every word that came from an angel, and an angel is a messenger from God. Every word that ever came from an angel was clearly understood by those they were speaking to. Clearly understood. Because the Word of God is understandable. And it doesn't matter what language we speak, whether it's English, Spanish, Greek, Latin, Asian languages, whatever language, it can be interpreted, it can be read, it can be understood, and it is useful for us. It establishes law and order, and in that law and order, it creates for us a sense of peace. Because it protects the vulnerable, doesn't manipulate for the sake of selfish gain. Instead, it protects the most vulnerable. Thought it was something worthy to share. You know, no matter what our religion is, no matter what form of rules or laws we decide to govern ourselves by, if it doesn't protect the most vulnerable, it's coming from the devil. And the devil seeks to confuse, mislead, and manipulate good people into believing it's okay to hurt, to kill, and destroy those who cannot protect themselves. Keep that in mind as we move forward in life. And I pray and hope that one day you'll take the stand for something you believe in. Heavenly Father, we just ask that you would allow your Holy Spirit to flow through this video into the hearts and minds of those who are watching today. Bring order to their lives. Bring submission to their spirits, their souls, that they would submit to your will, your righteousness, your justice, and your love. protect over each and every one of us, and continue to shine that great light upon our path, because we know it's guiding us home. In Jesus' name, amen.